Hello, and welcome to the first section of the Planning and Prepping module for the Community Garden webinar series. I'm Bruce Black, a horticulture educator with the University of Illinois Extension. In this section, part one, your blueprint to gardening, we will discuss where to purchase plant materials, variety selection, differences between hybrids and heirlooms, where to place your garden, planting dates, vegetables based on those planting dates, and making a garden layout. When planning your community garden, selecting plant material is always the easy, yet sometimes daunting task at hand. Depending on your type of garden, you may use transplants or seeds. When purchasing plant material, there are a variety of places you may look. Locally, your garden centers and box stores will offer some variety for you to choose from. On the other hand, catalogs and online businesses have a greater variety and may have that niche plant that you are looking for, or didn't know you were looking for, but want to now incorporate. Whether seeds or live plants, you should always want to buy the best disease-free quality plant you can. This can be hard when you have the option of a good deal on the clearance rack, but we don't want those good deals to cost you more in the way of a disease infection. Varieties for Illinois should be zoned 5A through 6B, depending on your location in Illinois. For recommended vegetable varieties, please visit the University of Illinois Extension's Illinois Vegetable Garden Guide at web.extension.illinois.edu/vegguide. The link is on the slide. Hybrid plants are created when breeders intentionally cross-pollinate varieties, attempting to produce an offspring that contains the best traits of those parents. During hybridization, pollen is carefully handled to make sure that the right plants are crossed. Hybrids are created for characteristics such as increased size, better disease resistance, varying acidity level, as well as many others. Hybrid seeds harvested and saved will not have the same traits as the seeds you planted due to those seeds or those plants being pollinated during the growing season. Heirloom varieties are the varieties of the past, usually pre-World War varieties that have been handed down through the generations via seeds. These seeds have been selected by gardeners for a specific trait. Heirlooms are open pollinated by the insects or the wind. There is no intentional human intervention. These varieties have been noticed, picked, and then the seeds have been saved for future generations to regrow more of that variety. Some gardeners say that heirlooms have a better flavor than their hybrid counterparts. I recommend taste testing varieties, old and new, and finding those that your family will enjoy. Hybrids tend to be more uniform in size and in development, while heirlooms offer more variation. Vegetable gardens should be planted in areas that get full sun for a minimum of 6 hours a day. 8 to 10 hours of sunlight is ideal. A great way to measure the hours of sunlight is to watch how the shadows fall on your potential garden plot. Step out into your yard multiple times during the day and snap some photos of how the shadows of the trees and the structures move across your landscape. You also want to position your garden on flat or gently sloping, well-drained soil. Flat ground offers protection from frost pockets, which are areas of cold air that settle into low spots. Flat ground will also offer protection from water movement. When placing your garden, access to water is key. Water is essential for plants. Having a hose or rain barrel near your garden is a requirement unless you have a way to transplant water to your garden. Gardens may be located anywhere on your property. Having it close to your home or your organization is one way to remember to take care of your garden, as well as easier for people to get to the garden. Plant hardiness is the ability of perennials to survive varying cold winter temperatures. In Illinois, there are 5 major plant hardiness zones as seen on the map. Major plant hardiness zones are formed based on weather and climate data. You can also have microclimates in your yard, areas differing from the general region due to local environmental and structural influences. These influences may raise or lower your temperature a bit. General trends in Illinois. The further up you go in Illinois, the shorter the season. The rule of thumb is for each 250 miles north you go, the growing season is shortened by 1 week in the spring and 1 week in the fall. Northwestern Illinois tends to be the coldest region in the state. Areas near Lake Michigan, the spring and the fall come later. And in southern Illinois, they have greater averages of rainfall. The time to plant specific vegetable crops depends on their frost tolerance. Generally, very hardy and frost-tolerant crops should be planted early so that they may mature before the intense heat of the summer arrives. And some may also be replanted for a fall crop. Tender and warm-loving crops, on the other hand, can be damaged by late spring cold temperatures, so hold off on planting those until frost is unlikely. The Illinois Spring Freeze Map shows dates in which 90% of the years between 1981 and 2010 have had their last spring freeze before the date listed. Some examples are Rockford, with a late spring freeze of May 14th, Chicago, late spring freeze of April 28th, Peoria, April 27th, Springfield, April 22nd, Mount Vernon, April 24th, and Carbondale, April 25th. The Illinois State Water Survey website at www.is.illinois.edu/ATMOS/STATECLI/frost/frost.htm allows you to access more frost date maps for temperatures and different ranges in the data. The Illinois Fall Freeze Map, on the other hand, shows dates in which 90% of the years have had their first fall freeze before this date. Some examples are Rockford, October 22nd, Chicago, November 8th, Peoria, October 28th, Springfield, October 26th, Mount Vernon, October 25th, and Carbondale, October 26th. Very hardy crops, such as spinach, broccoli, cabbage, and the others listed on the slide, should be planted 4 to 6 weeks before your area's frost-free date. The University of Illinois Extension's website, Illinois Vegetable Garden Guide, at web.extension.illinois.edu/vegguide/step06.cfm talks about planting times and gives you more information on how to plant these specific crops. Frost-tolerant crops such as beets, chard, radishes, and the others listed on this slide should be planted 2 to 3 weeks before your area's frost-free date. Tender crops such as snap beans, sweet corn, tomatoes, and summer squash should all be planted on your area's frost-free date. Warm-loving crops such as lima beans, cucumbers, peppers, and others listed on the slide should be planted 1 to 2 weeks after your area's frost-free date. Now remember, your frost-free date, looking at the maps, are averages, so make sure to pay attention to your local forecast to determine if a late spring frost is likely after the average planting date. Frost-free days are the average number of days between the last drop below 32 degrees in the spring and the first drop below 32 degrees in the fall. On average, Illinois ranges from 160 to 190 frost-free days a year, allowing for local produce to be grown. Growing seasons become shorter as you move north towards Rockford and the Wisconsin border. Frost-free dates determine the cultivars of plants that we are able to grow in Illinois. Each fruit and vegetable has a date of maturity, a date that you want to be less than your location's frost-free date. When a plant is chosen that has a date of maturity more than the number of frost-free dates for your location, you may run into freezing and cold temperatures before the crop has the ability to mature. When planning your garden, making a map is a great way to determine what you envision and what is practical. As gardeners, we often want the biggest and the best for all of our plant friends, when in reality, we only have a finite amount of time and a finite amount of space to work with. Drawing a sketch of your garden gives you a roadmap to making it a reality and helps you when estimating your supplies needed as well as time to be spent. In a community garden situation, this is especially important when you are restricted to a specific plot size. When doing an overall garden map, it is a good idea to include the areas of each, the measurements for each location for planting, any walkways and their width, as well as any obstacles you may have in your garden area, such as benches, fencing, garden art, and many others. Making a map of your garden is a great helper when you determine what you want to plant. Having this as a resource allows you to keep it on record to develop a rotation. This rotation will allow you to keep any soil-borne pests and diseases from building up too quickly. If you're a community garden organizer, working with your community garden members to determine what they want to plant can also help you in building your rotation. This ends part one of the planning and prepping module. In the second part of the planning and prepping module, the following will be discussed: garden space saving techniques, prepping and fertilizing soils, and proper use of manures and compost. Thank you for watching part one.